in a sense, are the keys on the solution. Okay, I'm reviewing what I did in the last what we have found is that the isonthal solution is given by a connection in terms of this matrix U, where this matrix U is okay. Let me first write all the solutions, and then I will say all the properties I use for this matrix. Then, essentially, the connection is given in terms of U, a fermion in terms of a new matrix K. This is a fermion in the fundamental. A fermion in the anti-fundamental is given by in terms of U bar, because U, remember, U transform is an N plus 2K times N. Therefore, this is therefore, this is a matrix n by n, because it's in the adjoint of the group. This is a matrix n, okay? And this is a matrix like n bar, but like n. No, it's a different element. And then an adjoint alpha should be given by u bar u, and to address in the middle, I give a name. Okay, and what we see is that the expression of this kind always satisfies the Dirac equation. All fermions fitting in this way satisfy the Dirac equation. It's simply d alpha of alpha acting on a given fermion. We call generically the fermion by psi alpha. This is the Dirac equation, and this Dirac equation is satisfied for any matrix K and M, okay, if M satisfies this property. Okay, and I remind you that delta was defined by delta bar U. Delta bar U, U bar delta is equal to 0, and then let me start. And there was also condition over delta, which was delta bar delta. Okay? Then just using these these relations, you can prove that all these fermions satisfy the Dirac equation and that this connection satisfies the Phi equation for Jamming, which simply says this is something. Okay? Then what we want to do now is, okay, first let's write all these in components and let's count the degrees of freedom. We already count that the modular space of the instanton was 4kn dimensional. Now we add fermions, and every time we add fermions, we add new degrees of freedom. You remember this matrix, ki, okay, let's write the indices. This was lambda u. Okay. This is lambda j, k, I, and this is k, I. Okay. You start from here and you will immediately see what is the index of the matrix. I mean, this is lambda I, so this is u lambda. It should be lambda I, because f is ij, and this is k. Again, here, it's the same. I u lambda. This is lambda I, ij, j lambda. Okay, therefore we have the matter moduli are all here in these two matrices. Delta, we say that was a matrix you wrote like this, omega, U, I am above, A, alpha, I, J, alpha, plus xn times the constant matrix. This was constant. This did not bring any moduli. Okay? Then all the moduli, all the Mosonic moduli are in this matrix. While fermionic moduli are here, M, which we say is a matrix lambda times I. Or we can write again this way. Let's call mu to this component, U, I, and let's call to the other component M, which is alpha. Alpha, here, so this is, let's call this, this I, and this is J. Okay? Therefore, you see, all the non-trivial space-time dependence of instanton and fermions is codified in this matrix. There's no new information. Okay? Just using the fact that delta is so simple, depending in X, you can show that all this is codified equation. Okay? This is the constant matrix. Okay, let's say, okay? But, okay, it's okay, we can put one, let's write this equation. Okay? If I take delta bar, n plus n bar delta, okay? There are two pieces, no? One piece coming from this term, xn. Let's see what this would be. This would be xn b bar n m plus n bar bn. Okay? And then there was the piece where I take the A from here. Let's call this matrix, let's call big A. So this would be A bar n plus m bar. Okay. Now you see that B, Bn is just like right here. Okay, therefore, these two, this B bar n will be this part here. This will be xn times sigma bar n times, okay, I put this, I'm just doing zero, sigma bar n multiplied by mu n alpha. Okay. Okay, this is my bar is alpha dot alpha. Therefore, what I have here is that this sigma bar n alpha. This is I call n is this big matrix. Normal n is just this component. Plus n bar. Sigma n bar, let me write components. If I plus alpha n alpha plus n bar alpha and sigma n sigma n half index alpha. Beta dot, let's write in the same position. And then this is a mathematical right here. this will be the first part, and then, okay, both should cancel. This should be zero, and this should be zero. Okay? We want that this is zero. This was the constraint. Therefore, this condition simply says that it should be zero. See, this is just saying that this matrix N should be real. I mean, the complex conjugate of the matrix is related to the M bar, and M are not independent. They are related by this condition. It should be zero. Okay? Therefore, I can always use then M instead of M bar. And for this part, I will get one condition, which looks like A bar, this is like that. This is, let's see this part. Omega bar. Omega bar. A bar multiplying by mu m plus mu bar. A bar multiplied by omega. Okay? Then you write this in component. This is just omega bar times mu. Mu. Remember, omega bar, this was a matrix I u. Okay? And this was the matrix u. Mu is u. Uj. Okay. This is this part. And then here, turn that. Okay. Then I will have this part, which is a bar alpha dot alpha m alpha. A is also matrix A by IIJ, and this is KK, let's say IK, KJ. Okay, plus a Mitchell conjugate, which is. Okay, therefore, you see, here we have a constraint. Let me go to this constraint. Lambda is a fermion, it's a fermionic constraint. We have an index alpha dot and index IMG. Okay. Why? For the bosons, let's remember for this boson, this condition, we already wrote yesterday, and we see that this condition was written in the form of omega alpha dot, is a bar alpha dot. A alpha beta dot times tau c was equal to zero. There was three conditions, three was all conditions. Therefore, I just put this. And two fermionic constraint, 2k squared, because also this is a matrix. It was iu, uj, ik, kj. Therefore, this is a matrix k by k. Therefore, there was 3 k squared bosonic constraint and 2 k squared fermionic constraint. Okay? Therefore, the idea is you take these numbers, any number, you take four, all these numbers, impose this constraint. This means you subtract 3 k squared of 10, you can fix. Solving this. Take square more, you fit this was. Then let's now count the release of it. The number of zero moles. Okay? Now, for bosonics, we start from 4 kn. Coming from W plus 4k squared coming from A, and then we subtract 3k squared coming from taking this is equal to 0, and k squared coming from the UK. can we get 4K and dimensional space? Then now we see that when we add the fermion, every time we add an adjoint fermion, we start from, this is n, k, n times k, this is complex, for 2k n degrees of freedom. Okay? Plus n, this was 2k squared. 2k squared. Plus 2k squared, but then there is 2k squared. This was coming from mu, this was coming from n alpha, and then there is 2k squared coming from lambda equal to c, which means 2kn. 2kn times the number of adjoint. Okay, now what about the fundamentals? If I have a fundamental, I have no constraint. I can just take this k, whatever I want. How many they are k of them. Sorry, this, yes, just k. And the fundamental is the same. And this is k times the number of fundamentals. And then it's for anti-fundamentals. Okay, therefore this finish with the construction of this. From now on, what we will do is we have all these parameters, which are free, and they simply classify different solutions. Then we will take a correlator or some quantity, some physical quantity, we should evaluate the action in the instant of background, and integrate over all possible ones. The action will be evaluated in the instant of background. This will give a number, but it's a number that depends on these parameters. Then we should do this integration and find what is the result. Okay? Okay, but what I have said here was just always reduced to the linear order. I did a lot of approximations. Therefore, if I would like to do a computation in QCD or in any theory which there is no asymmetry that allow me to stop at this order, I should include all the interactions. Therefore, I should repeat all what I have done, start to modify the solution. Okay? And this is very complicated. Nobody knows how to do. Okay? Then what we will do from now on is consider this very simple series, which they call supersymmetric, in which there is a symmetry that says that all what I forget about don't give any contribution. Okay? And the idea is very simple. It's a theory that has a boson and fermion. So imagine you have a gluon, okay? And the gluon coupled to everything which is large. For example, if you have a fermion, you have this type of connections. You have a boson. We'll find also another correction of this type. Okay? Or even the same gluon. So imagine you have a gluon and a fermion. And what happens to the fermion? This contribution contributes minus. And this contribution is a boson contributes plus. If there is a symmetry that they change between boson and fermion, the value of this will be the same as that. And this will cancel. And this is the idea of supersymmetry. Supersymmetry is that there is a strong symmetry that's very boson and fermion. Since bosons always contribute to the opposite signs and fermions, many corrections will be canceled. Of course, this will not be true for anything, for any quantity. This will be true only for particular correlators, which are, we say, that are protected by supersymmetry. Okay? And we will just compute those. We will focus only on those computations, the only one that we know how to do. Okay, but already from there, there are a lot of things that you can understand. You can see signs of confinement. You can see a lot of things just looking to this this part of the city. Okay, then today I will start with a review of supersymmetry. You are now learning supersymmetry. I will review the I will need n equal 2 and n equal 4 supersymmetry, which is a bit more than what you are doing in the other course. Therefore, I will give you essentially very quick, let's say, review of all what I will need. Okay? Such a way that you can follow the rest of my discussion with this simple. Of course, you will understand the meaning of all what I am saying later in the course of supersymmetry. Okay, then what is supersymmetry? Supersymmetry, as we said, is a theory, is a symmetry of the plane. Relate bosons to fermions. In particular, the case I am interested in are supersymmetric gauge theory. This means that you have a vector, okay? You have also, you can have also scalars, okay? And then you have fermions that are related to this variable. For example, if a vector is in that joint, then you should have fermions in that joint. Let me call lambda, okay? Alpha, lambda bar alpha dot. Okay, it's a Dirac fermion, always contains the part lambda alpha and the part lambda bar alpha dot. Okay, and how many components we have here? We have a 4, it's a vector, but okay, a vector in 4 dimensions, it has 4 degrees of freedom. The massless vector has 3, therefore you have 3 components here. You have 2, and 2 are 4. Therefore, we need one more. Let's call B. Then essentially the idea is that we will group we will call this a multiple. A multiple is a group of boson and fermion with the same number of degrees. Okay? Then we will relate. There will be a symmetry that we write down explicitly that relating this AM to lambda alpha and alpha to D and so on. All these fields in the same multiple will be together. And this should be in that joint, because the vector should be in that joint. Okay, what else I can do? I can construct something we call Kyler. This is a scalar, complex scalar. For example, if you have SUN, you have representations are complex, therefore the natural things take a complex scale. Some fermions. Now let's count again. Here you take two components, here is only one, both are complex. This is two and this is one, then I need one more. I will call it. Okay? And this will be the main model I will use. Okay? This will define what I will call n equal 1. Any number of chiral multiples in any representation of the group, and one multiple, one vector multiple in the actual representation. I will write down the action, I will write everything now. But I'm just first want to give you the main ingredients. Okay? Now this will be n equal 1. Okay, let's start with n equal 1. Okay, now I should tell you how these things are related. And I will use what is called the superfield formats, which is more or less, I think, one lesson of this lecture is that in physics, many times you are doing a computation and you see it's very complicated. Typically, it's because you are using the wrong variables. There's always, see this case, no? The self-dual connection, F, is a very complicated expression. We don't know. For k equal to 2, 3, nobody could, you would expend 10 days to write to take all the ingredients I need and try to squeeze the cake or to see. But delta is very, it's a trivial sign. Delta is just a linear image. Okay. What I will do here is exactly the same. I will write down some super field, I will write an object. It's a bit complicated, but out of this object, every supersymmetric action is given in a trivial way. Okay? Then what I will pack all this together with something I call super field, which is given by this expression. You see, you want a vector, okay? Then you want a vector, okay, then you should take the sigma matrices, and yes, just write in them this superfield. Superfield will be something we have, but all of our fields depend on S, the variable of S. If I want supersymmetry, I want to introduce a sort of supersymmetric part of this value. Let's call this theta. Okay? And I'm writing something that is explicitly depending on these two variables. Of course, in my physics, only x I will see. It's also the way I'm going, I'm enlarging my space to write something simple. Okay? Then what I think, since this is fermion, I can always expand the theta. Before I will have some first component in theta, theta squared, theta, and so on, tilted to a 4. Okay? Then I want a vector. I start AN. If I want a vector in terms of theta, the only thing I can do is with the power with the theta matrix. This sigma for me is alpha fat. Okay? Then what is the next? The next will be lambda alpha. And alpha means just contract with some theta alpha. Okay? And then they should not work. All the rest should be scalar, therefore this is theta bar. Theta bar is a scalar. Okay? Then alpha dot. Plus lambda bar alpha dot, theta alpha dot, bar, theta squared, and then finally, 1/2 squared. And you see, we have all the components of the multiplet. Okay. You could, why I didn't have to say them like theta. Okay. Theta, so you could do also. In other words, you see, this is a bit shorter. You would expect that this starts from something constant if theta is a 4. It's a bit shorter. This is just a consequence of Gaussian value. In the course of supersymmetry, you will see how you can start from something longer, fix the gauge, and arrive to this. Okay. For our purpose, it's enough to just take. We are already using this case too. I'm just saying that you could put extra stuff here, theta, theta bar, and so on, and work with all this stuff, and you will see that all these are redundancies. Okay, we have already B, and we can do the same for C. C. For C, for example, I just start with 5 plus 5 times. Oh, sorry, every field here is a field of x, of course. So this is 1 times. Okay, so I have here 5. Then I have theta alpha psi alpha plus theta squared f, okay? I almost finished, but then there are more, no? You could have theta bar and things like that. Let me write the full expression, and then we will come with the nice thing is that you will never need for all what I'm writing. I'm just giving the precise expression because you see the type of things that you can get. This looks very complicated, but let me anticipate that this can be written as 5K. Where J is Xn minus okay, the crucial point is that all this complication you can remove by a change of value. And since we will integrate over X, okay, this will not you can just simply use. By the way, what I just wanted to say is that you have two square fields. And our idea now is to see how this field, this is just a definition. For the moment, I'm not doing anything. I just put this all this together. And now I will show you how supersymmetry can read from this. Okay? And then it's very simple. You simply define Q as, sorry, variation of a super field. The variation of any square field, this phi could be either B or C or whatever, is epsilon half Q alpha. It's an operator, which acts very simply in this way. It's just a derivative. Q alpha is just d theta alpha. Index bound for alpha dot alpha. Okay, then what this means that let's see what is the variation of V. Variation of V is variation of A theta sigma n theta bar minus I lambda alpha variation of lambda theta alpha theta bar square. But since the variation is also this, then we can evaluate this and say this is epsilon alpha q alpha. This is q alpha. Let's act here. If I act with this in this super field, you see that I get, if I the derivative of theta act here, I get theta IAN sigma n theta bar. Okay. If the derivative acts here, I get minus sorry, AN, this is theta alpha. Okay, then this is epsilon alpha, now it's contrast with this sigma n. This is alpha, 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 okay. And I'm doing this part, okay. Then this one, where was? Yes, then this one will be minus I, okay, plus epsilon alpha, times Q alpha. Q alpha is also this, minus I sigma alpha dot n theta bar alpha dot dn of a dn, this will be n, let's say n dn of a n times theta sigma n theta bar alpha dot okay. You have a lot of terms, but let me just write the one that I'm interested in. I would like to look for what is variation of the of a. Okay, then I should look for in this variation something that have theta sigma n theta bar n. Okay, then this will come from this term, because if I add, this will come from this term, no? Because if I remove one theta here, you get theta theta bar. Okay? Therefore, let me write this term. Plus I epsilon alpha lambda bar alpha. The derivative in theta will act here. The bar theta alpha dot. There will be a theta. This was theta alpha theta alpha. For the actor here. And let me see how this was alpha dot. Okay, now, and then there will be several terms more. Okay, but now you see that these two things are equal. Then the term theta theta bar should be equal to the term of theta theta bar. Therefore, this is saying that the variation of AL is related to sigma bar alpha dot epsilon alpha delta bar alpha dot sigma n alpha. Okay? With some number here. I. Therefore, I don't need to do the computation. You can just evaluate all this and read all the variations. And in the course, I suppose that you will read explicitly all the variations. I will not do explicitly. I will always work with these two objects. The important point is that you know that this defines the variation of this one. Okay. Let's also observe something very interesting. No? What about the variation of this field, of the last field? You see, the variation of the if you have a superfield, any superfield, you will have some first component, and then you will have the last component. Let me call phi 4 theta squared theta bar squared. Okay? Now, if I take the variation of this, I should look in this action. This is, we say that it was epsilon alpha u alpha acting on the field. Okay? Then this is epsilon alpha. Dvd alpha plus theta sigma m theta bar dn of sorts of phi. Okay, this was the definition. And then you have also the bar. Okay, now you see that the variation of this, I should look for something that have four thetas. Cannot come from here. Because the derivative something and need something with phi theta, but there is no phi theta. It's stopped at 4. Therefore, this term cannot contribute to this variation of phi. While this term is a total derivative. Okay, great. Then any superfield, when I integrate, is automatically supersimple. You take any superfield, any combination of this, b squared, b, psi q, c to the 4, whatever you want, you take the last component, this last component, you can write the Lagrangian as integral difference times the last component of any superfield. And you see, in this way, we are able to construct any supersymmetric Lagrangian in a very simple way. It's very hard to check that it's supersymmetric. This will be three lines of if you're writing on points, this will be three lines. But we know already that it's supersymmetric, because this is automatically a total derivative. The variation of Q is a total derivative. The integral of a total derivative does not contribute to the action. Therefore, this is automatically supersymmetric. Therefore, the variation of L. Then the idea now will be just write actions taking combination of these DLC. Questions? Okay, now I will write the most general n equal 1 action for an n equal 1 supersymmetric case theory. You see, the only thing that I need is this. Okay. Then the most general n equal 1 gauge action is given by this. You can have two types of terms. You can have integral v form s d 2 theta v2 theta bar, okay, of, you see, I want the four component of a superfield. A way to pick the four component of the superfield is take v2 theta bar, phi. It's automatically. This integral pick up the four component. Okay? Now, let me write this. I will take some chiral field. For example, you can have some chiral field. Let's call phi. Not too confused with this. Let me call this in a different way. Okay? Let's say you can take, for example, any function. Imagine you have a complex field in some representation. Okay? You take any function of this field and phi bar. Okay. And integrate over theta and theta bar. This automatically is supersymmetric. And this phi can be whatever, how many you want. Okay. You have a set of chiral fields. Every phi I, phi A for me will be phi A plus theta psi plus theta square. Okay? You just take this plot here. This will be a function. But, you know, let's use a few things. What you can get from here? For example, you can take the four components of theta from here. You can take either f is theta squared, you can take f bar is integral before s. You can take f bar. This is automatically, look to here. This is automatically, f bar is proportional to theta squared theta bar squared. Therefore, it should be here. What else? I want to do this times the bar of. So, I'm saying it very simple stuff. Imagine that I take for k. Imagine I take for k the simplest things. This is the general case. Now let's take for k, phi phi bar, just the problem. Phi phi bar. Okay? Now let's see what is the Lagrangian. The Lagrangian will be integral. d4x, d4 theta is the same as keeping the phi phi bar, the theta squared theta bar squared. Okay? And what is that? Let's say, for example, if I take this square, this times the same square, then theta 4 is, for example, if I take this one with this one, okay? And there will be a term like this, 5 times 5. Then there will be a term coming from this with this. That will be psi d psi. There will be a term f with f bar. F with f. And you see, you have already here the kinetic term for the scalar, the kinetic term for the fermion. This is an auxiliary field. This is an auxiliary in the sense that this, you remember, we introduced just because we don't have the right degrees of freedom. But you see, there is no kinetic term for this field. So for the equation of motion for this field, we will be an algebraic equation that I can solve. Therefore, f is not a real degree of freedom. It's something that I can solve in terms of the other fields. And so on. Okay? Sorry, by the way, this stopped here, if I just do.
No, the m squared of dmp, dmp.
Dmp, we combine with this to give the kinetic term. Or to total derivative, of course, because this box you can write as dm, dm, and up to total derivative you can pass the dm on the side. Okay? Then all the terms are of the same type that we were studying. And now you can do the same. You can do 5 squared, 5 bar squared, and then you will find, for example, if you do things like that, you will find more complicated, which will not be in general. I mean, no, it's still an equal one.
Yes.
Okay. But I would like to have a vector field also here. No? And I would like that this is Gaussian value. Remember that this phi and phi bar transform respect to the gauge symmetry, then to write a supersymmetric action, what you should do is just simply put exponential to the v. And use the fact that under gauge symmetry, you take phi goes to e to the I alpha phi. Imagine you have this gauge protection, phi bar will transform by e to the minus I alpha. Okay? Therefore, this term, for example, let's come back to our case, phi e to the v phi bar. Okay? This will transform like e to the I alpha from here I e to the minus I alpha bar. Okay? And therefore, you see that this v, if you say that v, this goes to phi e to the I alpha. Alpha is a matrix. Okay? In general, all these are matrix in a linear representation. All this you will do in very detail. I just wanted to say is that you have this plus v and then minus I alpha bar phi bar. Therefore, v prime. Therefore, you want that this is equal. So this say you how V should transform in order to this be gauge invariant. Okay? Therefore, the message is that if you want to do a gauge theorem, the only thing that you put is that this act, this function, you evaluate into the gauge. Okay? And now let's see again what come out from this. For example, now you see that from here, I can now take an A from this V. V was here. V was, this was integral difference. And now there will be a new term coming from here. If I take this A, this is already theta theta bar. Therefore, I should take from here, from this product, just theta theta bar. Therefore, can be, for example, psi times psi times this complex formula with psi bar. Therefore, this will be something like I psi bar, which is what we need in order to, before we were getting that. Now, this together with this will make all the derivative will become covariant. For all the details of the Lagrangian will come out automatically. You just expand this function. Okay? And this exercise you will do very in detail. Don't worry, it's clear that it's too quick now. You don't need to worry about it. I will not need the actual components. I will just use these functions. Okay? For being careful, So I just wanted to say to you that it's very simple. You just, it's just a question of time. You just sit down there, expand this in details, and you will get there. Okay? Okay. I forgot to say that you can define also you can define another operator Q alpha now cancel. Well, you can define another operator P alpha and P alpha bar dot, which is almost the same formula that half Q. And the other about is the input. This is exactly the same form like Q, but with a different sign here. Just flipping the sign. The nice thing of this operator is that I'm commute with Q. And the same for D1. What this means? This means that I can also start from this super field, act with any of this operator, and find a new super field, which gives you more freedom. I can use, of course, this new super field has the same information. It's not a new state, it's not a new super field. It's simply just a different way to write the vector model. For example, I can define, which will be useful somewhere. Then together with these two vector and chiral, let me give a different look of this vector. I call W alpha this particular combination. This is, I just act with this operator in this thing, and I see what I get. And what I get is, of course, this lambda will start with lambda alpha, just a derivative, no? I take two derivatives in bar and one derivative in alpha, this will give me lambda alpha. Okay? Sorry, we'll start with lambda alpha, and then let me write the other two components. This will be lambda alpha plus ID delta for B minus Fm sigma n n. Theta theta plus I squared sigma n. Okay? This field, you see, is of this type. It's what we call chiral. Chiral is something that it has all components, but with a change of value, you can write just in terms of theta. So theta. This field is of this type. Everything here is in one. Okay? Why they are important? I say here that you can write supersymmetric things by taking the integral difference d4 theta of any superfield that depends on theta and theta. But I can also write a supersymmetry action just integrating into theta, I'm taking a field that depends only on theta and y. Okay, you see the derivative of theta will cancel all the theta bar that's coming from. For this will just, you can just use here y on x is the same. For after you put in this. Therefore, there are two types of Lagrangian I can grab. Either an integration in theta bar, or either integration. Okay? Therefore, I can use, I already did the most general one. Now let's see what we can do with two thetas. Okay? With two thetas, you can write, okay, this was S1, it was one part of the Lagrangian. Let me finish here. Then I can write integral difference d2 theta of any function of my chiral field, any holomorphic function, in such a way that this depends only on theta, not on theta 1. Or I can use this W alpha. Then I can write any function of this theta plus W alpha. Plus Hermitian. The reaction should be clear before that you do. Now, remarkable, this is the most general action for a gauge theory with any colossus. Therefore, the full action is codified in three functions. K, which is called the Keller potential. W, which is called super potential. And tau, which is called gauge curve. Sorry, we already see the type of terms that come from here. From here come all the kinetic terms for the scalar and from the forward effects. Let's see what comes from here. W alpha, W alpha. I need all the theta squared. I can get either theta theta from here, and I will have F squared. See, this is the kinetic term for the gauge field. Okay, or I can take this with this, and this will give the kinetic term for the region. See, I'm just taking now this square. There are two possibilities. Either I take the square of that, or I take this with this. All of them give theta squared. Then this term gives the kinetic terms for the gauge field. And this is why I call this gauge curve, because this is a function that tells me how strong is the curve. This was the analog, this tau. Okay, let me. This tau, in all what we have done till now, this tau was simply 1 over g squared, 4 g squared. Now we are saying, this is more general. It's a function in which the gauge curve depends on my fields. Really complicated, actually. Okay? This is the most general. Okay, but the nice thing is that you see, in two lines, you are able to write the most general action in terms of three functions. This is very, very, very strong statement. Also, because this function is a holomorphic function. And we know that holomorphic functions are very restricted. Holomorphic functions, we have all the complex analysis. I mean, we have a lot of. It's a very restricted class of functions. It's a very particular class of functions. Indeed, all what I will do in this lecture is focused in this part. Most of results in the last 20 years have been just in that part of the language, which is holomorphic. And I can treat with very strong power analysis.
Sorry, that W of the super field plus the other Is the same W than the other one?
No, no. This is a, okay. Unfortunately, they use the same letter. It used to be SAF alpha.
Yeah, the other one doesn't.
The other one. No, the other one is a scale. It's a, this is just a function. They call that.
Ah, okay.
Yes. No, it's not the same. This alpha index, every time I write the W, I will write the index alpha to avoid this confusion.
Just curiosity, yes. Is there a particular reason for which you are not including the Fayette calculus, or it's just for
the Fayette calculus is here. It's D. Where is D? Here, D. This is the Fayette calculus.
Oh, so you include it in the.
It's there, it's there.
Okay.
If you give a F to D, this is what the people call Fayette calculus. If you have this action and give a value expectation value to this particular component, this will break the scene, of course, because you are giving something that is not H value. And this is what the people call Fayette calculus. Then everything is there. Everything you are seeing about supersymmetric L equal 1 H theory is there in this slide. And you can now, and you will spend a lot of time seeing all the consequences, because this is very superficial. But at least you just take this three ingredients. With these three ingredients, you can have this. Okay? Good. What then is? Is T11 T1 in septum? I have 1 hour. Okay, this is n equal 1. Now let's do n equal 2 and n equal 3. Okay, this is the simplest theory. Now, every other theory we construct out of the same ingredient. Because we already know that what we need a theory of more supersymmetry, this means a theory of more factors. Then what I do? Okay, we say that the vector was containing an, lambda alpha, lambda alpha dot, and a chirals containing a phi alpha, is n equal. All right, what is n equal to? Okay. Okay, n equal to 2 is the same as that, but now I would like to put an index here. No, I would like a two-fermion index. Okay, I would like that. Then what I do is I just take a vector plus a chiral in the joint. This was in any representation. This was in the joint. If I take a chiral in the joint, you see that I have one fermion here and the complex one. Chiral always contains also the C bar, no? If you have psi and psi bar, okay? You have psi and psi bar, and if you put together with this, you have the two fermions that you need. Okay? Then what we say is that n equal 2 is just a special case of n equal 1, in which you write something you will call vector of n equal to 2. It's a big multiple of n equal to 2, which is just vector plus capital of n equal to 2. And the chiral, of course, in the joint. The vector is always in the joint, but now I take the chiral. Okay? Then essentially, using this multiple is bigger because you have more variations. Okay, you have more thetas. If I do here, I should continue theta to the 4, theta bar to the 4. It will be bigger. But I don't care. I will always use an equal 1. Therefore, I will always use. I just say, I write the most general C, okay? But when now I have between my chiral things, I will give some chirals in the joint, okay? But there is a symmetry. There is a symmetry between them. Therefore, now this K cannot be arbitrary. This K should know that this particular chiral is the same as the vector. Therefore, this there should be a, so for this K and this W and all this should be restricted. Okay? But as the field content is the same. Okay, this is n equal to 2. Sorry, this is a vector, but you can write also what they call chiral, which is just a chiral in any representation plus scalable. Interpretation bar. So a chyla, another chyla in the bar in the concrete boundary. Remember, this is not chi, this is not chi bar. You can have a chiral representation and a chiral in the complex. Finally, is n equal 4? N equal 4 means that I need 4 of these guys. Therefore, I need a vector give me 1, I need 3 more. For vector of n equal 4, it's just vector of n equal 1 plus 3 chiral n equal 1. And that's all. There is no any other kind of thing. The way to see that there's no other type of module is that essentially for me it raises the speed. If you act with n equal 4 on a scalar, you will always arrive to a vector. There's no way to have a theory with n equal 4 superspeed that do not have vectors. It has to.
In which representation the chiral in n equal 2 is?
Here in the joint, and here in the joint. Well, here is for sure in the joint.
If I would like this kind of field to live in the anti-fundamental, for instance.
Yes, it's here, any representation. You cannot write vector in the...
No, yeah, but if I want the... Say that this chiral is in the fundamental. If I want it now in the anti-fundamental, how I would change the other side of this?
If you want R, let's say this is R is NC. If you want the anti fundamental, this will be anti plus fundamental.
And
this is a good point. There is no difference. In n equal 2, a hypermultiplet in the fundamental is the same. It's a good point. No? It's real. N equal 2 is real. It's non chiral, what we call non chiral. For example, in n equal 2, yes, this will. Okay, this is work for any representation. You take like what you're saying is that.
I just can put real representations in the graph. I just can put real representations in this
graph. Any representation. You put here any representation. Okay. Then, what are the restrictions on that? Okay. Then, let's see in any equal 2. In any equal 2, what happened is the following. Okay, now I think I can cancel this. Okay, I can cancel this. Okay, what happened in n equal 2 theory? Is that, for example, you have I say this k and this tau and this tau, you cannot be arbitrary. Now they are the supersymmetric constraint. What happens in n equal 2 is that the k, this k, can be written in this form. Where f is a holomorphic function. This is quite remarkable. In n equal 1, you have a function which is non-holomorphic. For this is very complicated, because for that reason, because you have this function. In n equal 2, everything you can have in terms of a single holomorphic function, which will be called the prepotential. F of phi, the fuller, everything here that we have now in terms of this. Is called prepotential. K was that, tau, phi, is second derivative. But no, let's just think about the let's just think about pure n equal 2. Okay? In pure n equal 2, you have just one chiral multiple. One chiral multiple. And this chiral multiple is in the vector multiple of n equal 2. You have a vector and a chiral multiple. If I call this phi, this will be simply f of phi. This is for pure. For a general n equal 2, it still is true. Now the formula will be more complicated. But the main point is that the full action can be written in terms of a single holomorphic function, which is called the Lebesgue function. And this is the main point of n equal 2. N equal 2? N equal 1, you have three functions, W, tau, k. N equal 2, you have just 1, f. N equal 4, how many? No, n equal 4 is fixed completely. Okay. For n equal 4, this W is simple. You have three chirals, n equal 4, and W is simply 5, 1, 5, 2, 5, 3. It's completely fixed. K is just 5 bar 5. Therefore, let's write n equal 4. N equal 4 is just that. S of n equal 4 is integral before x, before theta, a phi bar a, the d phi a, a go from 1 to 3, plus this, plus w alpha, where it was tau. Tau is now a number, tau is constant, w alpha, plus this, plus integral p for s, the theta squared component of that, and the theta to the 4 component of that. You see, n equal 4 is completely fixed. It's just the standard Lagrangian with a kinetic term which is trivial, 1 over the d squared f, and this particular potential, superpotential. Okay. Then omega 5, then n equal 2, this was the prepotential. In n equal 4, k is 5 bar 5, w is 5 1, 5 2, 5 3, and tau is constant. It's 1 over g. Here you can put an angle also if you want. But for if you won't forget it, just one. Okay? Then my message here was just that. A superspecific series can be written in superfields. N equal 1 series is given in terms of these three functions. N equal 2 is given in terms of a single function, which is called the prepotential. N equal 4 is fixed. Okay? Therefore, what we do in the rest of this course is to compute, to show some instant computation of the prepotential for n equal 1, also of the superpotential for n equal 1, and the computation of the prepotential for n equal 2. In n equal 4, we don't have nothing to do, at least in level, because it's there. Okay. Okay, good. Maybe we can break, make a break of 5 minutes, yeah. And then we will do the computation of the prepotential for n equal to 1. Or at least a start. Let's see how 5 minutes. 5 minutes is okay, or you need more? Or...
Is it right?
Yes.
Okay, I want to give you an example of instant computation for Angular 1 and an example for Angular 2. For, I will choose very simple example just to give you the idea of how you can, what you can do for any other Angular 1. Yes. Let's take, for example, Angular 1. SUM IPC with a quark, let's say a superfield in the fundamental and a superfield in the upper field. Want to distinguish up and down. Okay. Then the Lagrangian of this theory we have already seen. Post integral of d for s d for t of q q bar into the b q plus q t bar into the b t bar. This was the scalar potential, simple scalar potential. I'm now taking a kinetic term. I say you in general can have a very complicated scalar potential, which means that you can have very complicated scalar terms. For case theory, simply in the world standard model and so on, the scalar potential is clear, just pi bar phi. This is your problem. Phi bar phi. Then this is, I think, as the scalar potential. And that's all. And I would like, okay, what is that? This is a, sorry, I have also the kinetic term for the first one. It was tough. And now I have the trains. Okay, all this was trains. Okay, this is, okay, this is fundamental, adjoint, let's say, anti-fundamental, adjoint fundamental for this, okay? Well, this is a joint for a state trace, and I say this is here tau. Sorry, I'm writing the Lagrange. Okay, then you should integrate for. Okay, let's say the action. The action for tau is integral to pi. You see, this is the standard. Forget about, for example, you put theta to zero. Okay? It's what we have done all the time. Theta to zero, this will get here 4 pi over g squared. The 4 pi cancel. You will find 1 over 4 g squared. Plus the complex conjugate is 1 over 2 g squared, which is what we know this. Okay? Therefore, here, from here will come the kinetic term, I think, f squared and the regime. This was the part. Okay, this will come from here. And then from here, this will come that the kinetic term for these scalars. Also for the thetas, okay, there will, you will have the kinetic term, but you will have also the A, which will become covariant here. No, when I take an A from here, A scalar scale, you have seen that. And you will have also, you need four thetas, okay? You can take also one lambda from here.
We have the expansion.
Okay, let me write this function somewhere just to remind you. P plus A theta theta bar plus lambda theta bar squared theta plus lambda bar theta bar theta squared theta and A Q plus phi plus the theta sine plus, and then there was all the kinetic terms theta theta bar five theta square theta bar EC. Now, what come up from here? Okay, what I'm saying is just you have d5 you have from this term, okay? The A, we have already done this step also. You have theta theta bar from here, and then you take, for example, if you want A, this theta squared theta bar squared, and then you can take 5, A, 5, 5, don't bring anything, A gives theta, theta bar, then theta squared, theta bar squared, and this gives theta. Okay, in this way you can factor on the terms. But then the one I'm interested in now is five bar. Imagine I take 5 bar, and then I take 1 fermion from here, lambda, sine. This is what is called Yukawa. You see here, no? Lambda gives theta bar, theta squared, psi gives the extra theta bit, and phi doing bendings. You would have also the phi, psi bar, psi bar, but all of this in the instant of the RC. I can forget. Okay. What I would like to do now is take this action, okay, and evaluate on the instant of the solution of the equation. Okay? And you would say, okay, this is trivial, no? Because this, if you evaluate this equation of motion, okay, this is d of psi is 0. You have here the Dirac operator, this is 0. F squared, the integral of F squared gives a number for 4 pi squared k, k over something, you don't depend on anything. Scalar at 0, all this, the scalar was 0. This one, you have Laplacian of. Here you have the. Here, up to total derivative, there will be a term which is a total derivative of, let's say, let's do this more precise. This will be dn of 5 bar en phi. Okay? This derivative here, I can act as a total derivative minus the derivative acting on the second scale. 5 bar plus minus d squared 5. I'm just moving the derivative. And here you will have only one lambda sine. Okay? What I just wanted to say is that once you take an action, right, evaluate the equation of motion. What is the equation of motion for 5 bar? It's g that is c. What is the equation of motion for this psi bar? It's the this large psi c. Therefore, if you take the action and evaluate the equation of motion, you get c. Oh, total delta. Okay? Well, this is nice because since this is a total derivative, I can do the integral, the action, the integral of a total derivative. This integral will be the limit of this quantity here at infinity. Therefore, I don't need the full instant of action. I just need how the instant of action goes at infinity. Okay? Therefore, what we will do will be take the the Yamil action, evaluate at infinity, and see how they depend at infinity of the moment. Okay. Good. Now, let me get about that. This is the action I will be already at infinity. Let me keep this one. Okay, what I will do is the following. No? I will find something which is very like that.
Can you write again where you had that?
Sorry?
Can you write again where you had that? The one, the last line.
This one? This was a derivative n of 5 bar dn 5 minus plus 5 bar x squared 5 plus lambda psi, and then there will be.
So, why does the last term not contribute?
Which term? This is the
last one, the last term.
Yukawa.
This will contribute, this will modify the equation of motion. I'm just saying that if you evaluate on the equation of motion, this will, using the, once you put the, okay, for us this will be also zero because we said 5 minus 0. In our case, it is zero. But imagine that you start to include the interaction. I'm just saying that even including the interaction, once you evaluate the action on the equation of motion, this will cancel. If you would solve to the next one. But okay, for us, this you would say, okay, even this is zero. The 5 bar, we take all the scalar to see the incident. Okay? But, okay, I just want to say is that once you have an action and evaluate on the equation of motion, it's simply because what is the action? The action is the minimum. You have what is the solution of the equation? It's the minimum of the action.
Might be a constant.
Might be a constant, yes. Might be a constant. Yeah, we are interested in the dependence or asking. Okay.
So this is a general statement. There's nothing to do with supersymmetry.
This has nothing to do with supersymmetry. I mean, is it, let me don't say how general. I don't know how complicated it comes. I believe it's a general statement. Okay. Yes. For the standard interactions, polynomial interactions, and things like that. I mean. Okay. Then. Okay, just a point I want to do is I want to compute this defective function of this case here in the background of A. Okay? Then what should I do? I should take the integral. The starting point was I have an action and I have this. Okay? This was the starting point. I have all my fields and I want to integrate by Euclidean action over all the fields. We already said that this localizes some over K of an action, which is just this vibe, is just the instant of action. Okay? Therefore, I have integral over all the mode of Kn of e to the minus sc. Evaluate at the phi instanton k. Okay? Okay, let's come back to this equation one moment. Let me just write again what was this equation? Let me write it this way. Well, eta c is just some place of the sigma n. This was the equation for the scalar, and the equation for the Fermi. I just wanted to show you some significance of this two equations. what's mean by a omega phi omega bar alpha. A, sorry, mu, not just one mu, plus A, and alpha. I just want to show you that in these equations, if I take this were the moduli. The part proportion to the identity, this was a matrix scale by K. If I take A as a matrix K by K, the part, this part, this, just proportion to the identity, this will not enter in this side, in this. Therefore, this is really a moduli. This is a flat direction. This do not enter in the action. The action of the instant is not true that depend on more than one. Do not depend on this. Okay, this is the overall position for the instant. This is not the instant don't care where you put the if you move all together, the action will not depend on that. This is just a remaining of the initial Poincaré. I also will not depend on this amount. Finally, this proportion to the main. Again, this will not enter. Okay? Therefore, this section, which is the integral I have here, is zero. This is zero. Because here in this integral, I have also integral over this over position, cn, before dc, and d2 theta zero. And then there will be the rest. Okay? But this is nice, because this is what we expect for an action in the Yang-Mi theory. We expect that there should be an integral. This was, you remember, when we write the action for the prepotentials, we said that the prepotential is the integral d4x p to theta of the function of the things of the holomorphic. Therefore, what we will interpret as a prepotential is this. This will be the prepotential, and this will depend on all my fields, not q, q theta. Q, q theta. Okay? This will be a function of q. You see, essentially, you know what is this six here? You remember when we write delta, we write delta as WA plus 0x. Therefore, I can write this as U plus x, where x was delta g. Then you see that this delta, this the diagonal part of this A, the diagonal, the identity part of this, is just a chief of the X of the position. Okay? Therefore, it's nice. You can, if what happens when you do in the A background in the instanton is that this X0 you can reinterpret as the position in space time, because you could always reabsorb in a chief of the X, and the same for theta. Therefore, you will find a theory which is now again supersymmetric. But now the position and the theta zero are the position of the instant, and the theta is just one particular component of the fermion. Okay? Therefore, what we will compute is this part, this non-trivial part. Okay? This non-trivial part will give me the contribution of the instant to the festive function of the theory that is part. It's clear?
You're just saying that the position of the instanton is not important in the calculation.
I say that that you can, when you compute the effective function around the instanton, you can reinterpret the integral of the position of the instanton will become the integral of the space-time in the effective function. Because you can always, since the action, everything depends just on the sum, A plus X. There is no, you cannot split these two quantities. Okay, then integrating over the position of the instanton is the same as saying, okay, I fix space-time and integrate over the position of the instanton. Or I can fix the instanton at the origin and integrate over space-time. The same thing. Therefore, I can't tramutate it. Of course, here, then I would like now forget about this thing and just write this as a function. I would like to compute this function. Therefore, what I will do is I take this Q, which is superfilled. I will like you just to compute the lowest component, let's say phi. I'm fine. I will compute this in phi and phi. Okay? In other words, this is the integral we will compute. We take some phi and phi theta, some wave, for example, for this field, this scalar, which is inside Q or Q theta, and compute this integral. This we can evaluate. Going to the instanton solution, going to infinity, we will evaluate S of phi and phi theta. This will be a function that we will see now, but it's in terms of all the model of the instanton, all this model. We do the integral, and we get the answer.
So the hat means the moduli minus the...
minus the center of mass. Okay? This you can imagine as the coordinates of the center of mass of the super instanton. Okay? The super coordinates of the...
Can I ask a question?
Yes.
When we did the ADHM in the fundamental exam, we said it was a matrix, but now we see that it takes values in decimal numbers. To make it big, to do like the...
Sorry. It's a good point. I don't know if I say K and M are Grassmann
values. Are Grassmann.
Yes, sorry. I forgot to say
okay,
that.
Okay.
Because otherwise it's not a problem. And K and M are Grassmann matrices. Are matrices made of Grassmann numbers.
Okay.
Then this mu, what I call here mu, and M are always Grassmann matrices.
Okay.
Yeah, very good point. Sorry, I forgot to specify. Okay. Then, let's compute first the action. Let's compute what is that. Now, what I will just take the instanton background and evaluate this quantity here for a small phi. Imagine you take just phi constant and very small something. Therefore, this task will be just an phi squared integral for x. And then from here, you will find phi bar lambda. Okay? I would like to compute this very, very far away, at infinity. Let's compute the limit of this at infinity. How this goes, limit of this when the radius x goes to infinity. Okay, I will see. Let's see how this Lagrangian behaves at infinity. Okay. Let's first see we know the answer. And then we will evaluate the space. But you see that there are very few space here. This is phi, this should be phi u, phi bar u, okay? And A will depend just on what? On these variables, w, a, and so on, no? But the only thing that have carrier index u was w. A do not carrier index u. Therefore, this should be, it should contain an all u r here, and then contain another w bar. U. You see, the only way I can contract this index is I have something here with the moment I contract with this, I contract with that, and then the I should contract with this alpha dot, and contract with that. Therefore, the answer should be that. There's no, I cannot do anything more with that. We will derive this example. I'm just trying to say that Using the symmetry, this symmetry, so you can already know more or less what you think there. Proportion. At this time, what should be? This time is 5W. Lambda. Lambda depends of n. N and bar. Sorry, here there was bar. N minus n bar. Lambda depends of n. Linear n. And psi depend on k. And you see, nu, n was mu u I, and then contain is n alpha n alpha. And you see, the only thing that I can put here is the mu. And then the same for the thetas. Therefore, without doing any computation, you see that then just from the symmetry of the series, this is the only thing that can come out from the computation. Okay? Then the next lecture, we will start by deriving this. Okay, we have still 5 minutes. Okay, let's see if we can do it first. Okay, let's evaluate these quantities at infinity. See, this is nice exercise by itself. Just to see how the infinite will look like for us. Okay, what is delta? Delta was omega A plus X. Okay? Then at infinity, X is very large. Delta is almost omega X. Okay? Now, what is U bar? I want u bar, something that when I multiply with this, gets zero. Okay? Then, let me give you the answer, and then we check. This is u, let's say these two. We should have delta bar times u should be zero. Delta bar times u is omega bar times x bar times 1 minus x omega bar over x squared. Okay? Therefore, this is omega bar minus x bar. Remember, this again, sigma bar, sigma. Symmetrized, this is just identity, therefore this will be x squared. Cancel with this x squared. Okay. Therefore, you see, at infinity, we are able to solve this. We know what is delta, we know what is u. Therefore, we can compute everything now. Just plug in this formula, and let's see. An. But this an is u bar. This means 1 minus x omega bar x squared times derivative of this u, which is just 1 derivative of this guy. And then the derivative coming out either here, and you will have sigma n over x squared minus omega bar, or coming out here. Okay? Okay, when at here is okay, this computation we have already done. But okay, let's do it again. It's 2. Now here we have x to the 4. It's n. After 2, this x, I'm taking the derivative, this will be this square. Then the derivative of that is 2xn. And then you have this x omega bar and the sign is plus, because when you are here. So this is what you should compute. So here that was zero. Because the derivative of this is zero. Okay? And now you compute this stuff. Please believe me that this will be the answer. Okay? And so on. You can compute also fermions. For example, the fermions lambda will be 1 over h to the 4 omega h bar mu a, and mu a h omega bar. Now the details are not are really not important for any of this, because we know already the answer. I'm just saying that all this will come out from a fair computation. Then you see when you start to do a phi bar, you should take two of these guys, use the fact that sigma n times sigma n again give the identity, and all this would reduce to this term. An times An gives simply this. You already see, you have omega, omega bar, omega bar, omega. Omega bar, omega, you use the addition constraint to say that this 1 over x squared. And then this would be proportional to omega, omega bar. And the only thing that you can do is scale up. It's a nice exercise. Everything is in the notes. Please try to reproduce the action from the just from this asymptotic behavior of the, I mean, it's an exercise that you will not need longer, but just to give you an idea that this is how it comes out. Okay? And you can be worried about the fact that here you find 1 over x to the 4. If you do the computation, you will see that there is also a dependent on x. And rigorously, if you do this integral will be divergent, because derivative integral before x of 1 over x to the 4 is divergent. But you don't care about that because you can regularize that, put the volume at some point. And this will be a constant in front. This will change, I mean, all the x dependent path will give a number. We are not interested in that. We are interested in the bending of the mode, in the one that we will integrate. This number will be an overall number here in front of the action that we cannot fix. This is the normalization of the fields and things like that. Okay, we are interested in the depending on the fields, phi and phi bar, not on the overall cost. So the perfection of the okay, that's all. Okay, the only thing I wanted to say is that the action is this. And what we will, let me just write, and then I stop. Sorry for the delay. What we will do the next time is the following. We should take this effective action. We say that was integral before x before theta. And this is the integral that we want to compute. This integral will be integral over m and a, these two matrix. Or let's write explicitly. This will be integral over mu, integral over m, integral over omega, integral over a of e to the omega phi omega bar phi bar plus omega bar a mu plus the theta. UK plus tilde. The same for the tilde fields, no? You will find phi tilde, omega, omega bar phi tilde, all the tilde. This is what we will do. And for example, you already noticed something. This is an integral of Fermi. Then, okay, four of them, we already, sorry, two of them already we put here. But all the other, this will give zero. Okay? Then the only way this can be non-zero, if is this matrix n contain only this. It means if this matrix is one times one, it means k equal to one. Okay? Then already from this, we see that only k equals to one can continue. Sorry, this is not so obvious. This is not so obvious. Let's forget it. Because why is it not obvious? Because these variables are not free. We have also here the delta in DC. Remember, this variable satisfies the constraint, which we call this, we call DC. Star C. And this we call lambda. For here there is delta dc, delta lambda alpha dot. Okay. The same is true still. We will see that only k equal to 1 will contribute, but it's not obvious. Okay, then this is the integral. You see, it's an algebraic. These are numbers. All these are numbers. This is an integral. It would not be for that. This would, we would finish. This is a Gaussian integral. It would not be for this. Okay. But we see this is a very simple integral, we can compute and find the prepotential of n equal, of that n equal ones. Question? Okay, the second lecture is in the afternoon. I will 3 seconds.